one out of every three Americans is within driving distance of Cape Cod, and probably two, if not close to three out of every three Americans, knows the words Cape Cod. They know where it is, and they have like, ooh, I'd like to go see it.
Cape Cod is a magical place, a special place. Why? She is nothing more really than a big sandbar, always at the mercy of a furious sea. What makes people love her so? Is it because of that furious sea? In 1850, Henry David Thoreau wrote, "A man may stand here and put all America behind him." That is what makes Cape Cod special. She is where land and water meet. Cape Cod is land, but just barely. The ocean is in charge here. Her beauty and history move everyone who comes to the Cape. Cape Cod's beaches, bays, and harbors call to both the young and old. To fishermen, sailors, and beachcombers. To vacationers and retirees alike. Now she is almost built out. Soon there will be no more land available. Each year, the ocean rises and a little more of her is permanently covered by water. And the ocean keeps working away at the edges. For most of her life, though, the Cape was isolated. A place of fearless sailors and stubborn farmers who use their wits to survive and prosper in an often unfriendly land. In the 1600s, she was wild. The few natives lived comfortably off the land and sea. In the 1700s, she was tamed by farmers and fishermen. In the 1800s, towns and industry were booming. By 1900, Cape Cod's industrial age was over. She was saved by trains bringing sportsmen and wealthy patrons of large resort hotels. This is Cape Cod's story, told by Cape Codders, from her rich history to her hopes and dreams for the future. In the beginning, though, she was just sand formed during the last ice age.
I think the important thing to know is that unlike the rest of the continental United States, the Cape was actually created during the last glaciation, the last ice age. So the Cape is roughly 20, 21,000 years old, and that's all.
The glacier arrived here probably sometime around 20,000 years ago and stayed for a very short time. There was the Buzzards Bay Lobe, which occupied essentially with the site of Buzzards Bay, the Cape Cod Bay Lobe, and then the South Channel Lobe that lay to the east of Cape Cod. That's why the Cape looks like a bended arm. The glacial lobes created the primary shape of the Cape itself.
And at that time, sea level was about 370 feet lower than it is at present because the world's oceans were tied up in these vast continental glaciers.
As the large continental masses of ice melted, all the water that they contained returned to the ocean basins, and that caused sea level to rise.
When the Cape was formed by the glaciers, you could have walked southeast or east as far as George's Bank. 10,000 years ago, Nantucket and Martha's Vineyard were at the southern border of Cape Cod. They were part of Cape Cod. All of Nantucket Sound was dry land.
And as sea level rose about 6,000 years ago, it began to erode the Cape because the Cape is mostly sand and has no real resistance to wave attack.
The Cape is gradually diminishing, an average of 3 feet per year is disappearing on the outer shore. But that is not totally being lost. It's being redistributed into some of the beautiful sandy beaches, to the beautiful sand spits, to the barrier beaches, and to the Provincetown and Sandy Neck areas of Cape Cod.
Sand is the lifeblood of the Cape. And without that supply of sand, the barrier islands are going to essentially wash away and become nothing but shoals. If we destroy the barrier, then the marsh isn't going to last any length of time. And so we'd lose that whole ecosystem that so characterizes coastal maritime Cape Cod.
But the Cape in the future will be a vastly different landscape than it is today. And the Cape that is here today is a vastly different landscape than it was 10,000 years ago. It's commonly said that when the English arrived here in New England, they found the New World. Well, I like to think of them as having found a very old world, a world inhabited by native peoples for 10,000 years, a landscape that bore the traces of the 10,000 years of inhabitation. Each of the native communities on the Cape, and there were numerous communities or settlements out here in the 17th century, had a political leader who was known as a sachem. And a sachem's office was a kind of a different political strategy than a directly elected office. A sachem held power by building a consensus, by doing good for the people.
In the spring, they would gather around the brooks and areas where the fish were running, and whole communities would come together, different lots of families would come together. They would take the fish they needed and dry them over fires and things like that. In the summer, they would move in individual families normally to planting areas. Everybody was assigned an area that they could use for planting by the sachems of the tribe. Then the fall after harvest, they would store their corn and whatever they'd gotten during the summer in big storage pits or Indian barns, as the colonists called them later. And then they would move on to the hunting season. And in each case, they would sort of move house. It's like they would go from a summer house to a winter house. It wouldn't be in the whole house waiting there, but it might very well be the frames and poles that they'd put the mats or covering on.
The Pilgrims landed right in the midst of Wampanoag territory. In Truro, in Provincetown initially, and eventually down into Plymouth, which was all Wampanoag land.
I think in a lot of ways it would be similar as today if visitors from another planet came to Cape Cod. Some people would be fearful. Some would be welcome the chance to do business with these other people. Some people would have nothing to do with it.
They taught them what to eat. They taught them how to fish. They taught them how to hunt. What was good to eat and what was not good to eat. What was useful for medicine. Many of the English felt very thankful for that kind of learning that was passed on by the Indians.
It's interesting, a lot of people think that the first Thanksgiving, quote, between the Plymouth colonists and the native communities that surrounded them was a really special event, a big feast. Native peoples have been having feasts to commemorate important events, agreements, times of the year for centuries. For them to attend a feast with the Plymouth colonists was a very usual thing.
While the Pilgrims had reason to be thankful, it would turn out the natives did not.
One of the reasons for the decline was that the native people were not able to cope with many of the diseases that came with the Europeans. We had no immunity, and many plagues came along that the Europeans were able to combat. And our people died in large numbers.
Starting around 1618, there was a infectious disease, a real plague. They call it a plague, but we don't know exactly what it was. There's been many speculations on what disease it was, but the effect was that it just about wiped out the people in the coastal areas. They might have lost, we don't know how many people, but by the 1630s, when there'd been another one of these, they had lost 70% to 90% of their population just from disease. There was nothing else was necessary to basically completely change their situation.
Not only disease, but war decimated the Wampanoags. Relations between the Pilgrims and Indians often led to violence, culminating in the King Philip War of 1675. It was the last stand for the natives. The war remains as the bloodiest war on American soil, killing one of every seven colonist and Indian.
And so the theory was, with Native people, either go west or suffer very serious consequences.
Yes, I don't even know if it was go west, it was get out, or either blend in or be gone. That was definitely the version of what the colonists were offering them. Yes, when people did start moving to Cape Cod, the main way they hoped to support themselves was by farming. Communities in those days were not like Plymouth Plantation, a nuclear community with a lot of little houses in one place. Basically, there might be one or two public buildings, like down south, for example. And then you'd have outlying farms, each farm quasi-independent, but linked together as a community. And that's what they simply spread across the Cape. Of course, Cape Cod isn't all that great for farming, even for herding and things that they did. So they also used the sea more and more as the time went on. But it was always farming and harvesting from the sea as a combination of sources to support themselves and keep going.
Not only did they use the land and sea, they harnessed the wind and the water.
This place, like Long Island and Rhode Island, Connecticut, very windy. And so these guys are not too dumb. They said, how are we going to power grinding up the grain for meal? How are we going to, we need something. So they would use the tides, and they would use windmills, and they would use streams. When you use a stream, with one of those little water wheels on the side of the building, they were called grist mills. When you use the wind, you get these whirligig contraptions that are still dotted all over the Cape. And what's not around are the old tide mills. They used to have, like in a little inlet, they'd have a little narrowing of an inlet, where the tide would come in, tide would go out. They'd set up a mill where they could actually make use of the tide flow going in and out. They call those tide mills. There aren't many still around. Matter of fact, I don't know if there are any still around.
The miller was considered one of the top men in town because, of course, he was the only one that could run the windmill. Well, if you bought 10 bags of grain down for him to grind, you'd get 9 back, and the other was his tide. That's the way he got paid. Usually, retired seamen were hired to rig the sails and help the miller work the windmill, because the windmill, of course, worked probably 50% of the time. The other 50% of the time was used in repairing the windmill, because they didn't have the know-how, and it was trial and error, and it took a number of years before a windmill would work without breaking down all the time.
As farming spread across the Cape, it began to take a heavy toll on Cape Cod's forests.
The English perspective on this is kind of interesting. They lived in a country that was starved for wood. So when they arrived here in the New World, they were like a starving person finding a feast before them. And having so much wood in such abundance, they overused it.
In the early years, when the first settlers arrived, the Cape was heavily forested with hardwood. But over the years, every house that was built on the Cape was built out of that wood, and everything they heated their house with was wood that they cut down.
And think about it, as the population increases and the number of homes increases and the cold New England climate, they're burning a lot of firewood.
By the early 1800s, Cape was pretty clear cut. And then the Boston and Sandwich Glass Company came in here and they finished clear cutting Cape Cod.
The landscape that we see on the Cape today, for the most part, began to go through forest succession. And by the time, right around World War II, this forest that we see was beginning to come back.
Since the Second World War, the trees have grown up. So I remember when I was a kid, I could stand here and I could see all the way to Route 6. And I can see when you came up East Ham, up Route 6, you could see Nauset Light blinking. there weren't any trees. And because it was largely before then, it was an agricultural area and not a lot of homes. The minute the agricultural died out and all these second homes started cropping up, trees sprouted everywhere. But it's a large visual change since the Second World War. You know, you're surrounded by water, and you're probably as an early age learn how to row a boat and do all this stuff and you can dig for clams and all that. So the salt gets into your blood.
The Provincetown fishermen used to go out to sea, out on the Grand Banks, and fill their holes full of codfish. They'd come in and they would spread all of these fish on what they call flakes in the hot summer sun and dry the fish. They would reload it on board the vessels and pack it in salt and head for the Caribbean, where they would trade for sugar, molasses, rum, you name it.
Literally a lot of the early vessels, the clipper ships, the packets, the coasters, a lot of these vessels were piloted by Cape Cod boys.
Many times a captain would load up with cargo in Boston or New York and head overseas and unload his cargo and buy another cargo and end up going all the way around the world buying and selling cargoes.
And a lot of them made quite a name for themselves. They also made a lot of money for themselves. They come back and loaded with money and they build these fancy homes.
They would find a house that they liked the looks of in France or England or one of the other ports, Spain maybe, and they would copy the lines down and bring it home and hire an architect and build a house just like it for himself.
Some captains brought their wives and children along on these long voyages.
We had wives here that went to sea with their husbands for years and raised their children on the sea. She would teach her daughter all the housewifely chores that she needed to know, and the young boys would spend his lesson time with his mother, but then he spent the rest of the day with his father learning navigation and how to run a ship. There were a lot of Cape women who had their husbands die overseas, and they helped to navigate the ship home because there was usually the captain's the only one that knows navigation. There was a lady by the name of Hannah Rebecca Burgess. She married William Howes Burgess. She went on several voyages with him, and he died on a voyage. And she was determined that he would be buried back in Sandwich. So she had him put in a pickle barrel. And I think the barrel was filled with rum. But anyway, he was preserved so that she brought him back and buried him in the Sagamore Cemetery. And she's buried beside him.
The fishing tradition continues on Cape Cod with longliners, netters, and of course, lobstermen.
I started in 1947, and right after the war, and everything was hard in that time because you had to carry your bait down from the parking lot down to the boat. You know, like here, we're quite spoiled. We have a winch over there, we'd lower our bait on it and everything, but you'd walk down with two bushel baskets of bait, and then hopefully you'd walk back up with two bushel baskets of lobsters when you came in. You know, it was hard work on your hands, your back, you know, pulling the ropes and everything like that, but the pots were heavier. We all had wooden pots in those days, and now everybody's gone to wire probably in the last 20 years, and they're much lighter to handle. All you walk down the dock with a pot in each hand, where the wooden ones, you had to put extra bricks in them. It was a son of a gun. When you had that extra bricks in there, boy, you really did some work hauling, I'll tell you. I don't know how some of those older guys did it. But now most of these guys have got such a big investment in the boats, they go hell or high water. They just go out every day, and it's a shame. Sometimes I see them coming in pulling 300-400 pots, which they can, with a stern man, and they don't have any more than what we would catch rowing off the beach in the old days, really.
Although some of the technology has changed, the basic process of lobstering remains the same.
And you come to your first pot and you pull it. And you hope you got something in there. Then you take out what you got. You got to go through them, measure them, the carapace for 3 1/4 inches, and hopefully it'll be bigger than that. Throw any shorts or eggers overboard. One's got eggs underneath the tail. You throw them over. And then you can rebait the pot. And usually you'll move it 100, 200 feet to a little new ground and dump it. Unless you got a honey hole right there, and you might have a put it right back exactly where you found it. And then you go on to the next pot. And keep going on like that. Well, if all of a sudden you come to an area where you're doing well, you'll move some pots into that area. If you come to an area where it's kind of dead and has been dead for a couple of haulings, you'll pick up 8 or 10 pots or whatever and go on till you start hitting them again. We used to catch, you'd get 100, some odd, some days a lot more, some days less, 100 pounds a day out of the 65 pots. And boy, there's a lot of times now you're struggling to get 100 pounds a day out of 100, 125 or 30 pots. But back in the old days, they didn't have motors. In those days, they had to be sailing. They had to be rowing. And we all hauled by hand in those days. And we've all got fiberglass boats. There's no more wooden boats. And people got 200 horse outboards in the outboards. And even the big 35, 40 foot lobster boats, they all go 20, 22 or 3 knots, which is moving right along. We had a lot of years that never too many in a row. We'd have 3 or 4 or 5 good years, and you'd have a slack year. And then some years we'd have them, they wouldn't really come in, and we wouldn't start catching them till after Labor Day. And where usually you get in July, August used to be very good months in the old days. Even May used to be a good month. But then if you didn't catch them till after Labor Day, if they didn't start showing up till then, in the old days there was no one on Cape Cod to buy them, no tourists or anything like that.
Hauling traps is not always mundane. Sometimes a lobster man gets a surprise.
I got a grandson that got a student license now, has 25 pots out, and he fishes with me in the summer, and then he pulls his 25, and now I'm having trouble with him because doesn't want to go to college, he wants to be a lobster man. So it's one of a bad disease, really.
While some Cape Codders went to sea as sailors, others sent them to sea on locally produced boats and ships.
The ship building here started early too. They made whatever was needed at the time. If a man needed a house, they would build him a house. If he needed a boat, they'd build him a boat. They made small fishing schooners. And as time went on and they got more proficient with shipbuilding, they started building bigger ships.
The Cheverick Shipyards in Dennis was one of the birthplaces for many Cape Cod ships. Its location, however, made it different for most.
Most ships are launched either stern first or sideways, but the ships that were launched from the Cheverick Shipyard had to be launched bow first because the creek was not wide enough to turn the ship after it was in the water. And then the ship was towed to Boston and outfitted, and the mast was stepped. And these ships went all around the world and set records, and they were just absolutely gorgeous things to behold.
The Cheverick schooners were only part of the vast number of ships that were rounding the Cape each day. Add the notorious Cape Cod shoals and wicked nor'easters, and it's easy to see why Cape Cod was one of the most feared stretches of Atlantic coastline. In an effort to aid in navigation, lighthouses were established early on the Cape Cod coastline.
A lighthouse story on Cape Cod is one of considerable depth because the lighthouses were one of the features that helped save people from shipwreck on Cape Cod. The lighthouse service started way back shortly after the Revolutionary War, and Cape Cod was one of those sites where they realized early on a lighthouse was needed. So Highland was selected. The Highland Light had one solid, steady beam. So you knew it was Highland Light. And the Chatham Station had to have a different physical configuration than the Highland Light. So the solution was to have two steady lights. That made sense. So if you're coming from New York to Boston, you found two lights, you knew you were off of Chatham. You found one light, you knew you were off of Highland. But our story on Cape Cod continues because people were still shipwrecking off of the shores of Cape Cod, and they were often confused about their location. So it was decided that we needed another station on Cape Cod, and that was what was called the Three Sisters, the only triple light station in the United States. They were put here specifically because, again, you had one light to the north, two lights to the south. How do you distinguish another feature of Cape Cod? So three were in the middle. So you knew you were off the shore of Cape Cod if you were again headed north because you'd find a pattern of two, three, and one. And those three steady lights burned at the Nauset area for a number of years. And even Henry David Thoreau, though, walking through the area, looked at this and said, why three lights when one could do the job? And sure enough, technology was available and had been available for quite some time to have flashing lights. And that was when it was decided, why not have the Chatham light flash twice, the Nauset lights flash three times, and the Highland light have its own special code. So the Three Sisters were made obsolete, mainly because of a recognition that technology could still give this message. So there was no need for three lighthouses to be any other place around the United States, three standing alone.
Despite the use of these and other lighthouses, wrecks continued to pile up on the Cape Cod coast. It soon became apparent, however, something had to be done to aid shipwrecked sailors.
The life-saving service actually has its origins go back to the Humane Society, and there were little huts built all along the edges of Cape Cod, which were stocked with straw, some firewood, matches, water, things of this sort. So if somebody were shipwrecked and managed to find their way ashore, they would have some place to warm up and perhaps not die of hypothermia.
Sailors were issued a life-saving booklet that included a map of the hut's locations, but finding a tiny hut after fighting their way ashore was never easy.
Everybody knew it was a feeble attempt, but it was noteworthy. So the establishment of the United States Life-Saving Service occurred in 1872, and Cape Cod was one of those areas where Humane Society initiatives were redoubled, and the federal government came in and built 13 stations out here on Cape Cod. These stations were really remarkable because they were state-of-the-art. These were exceptionally well-built structures. They were built with very detailed specifications by the United States government, and they were staffed by a crew of the most talented individuals that could be found anywhere along the shoreline. It was an actual federal service exam that was required of the lifesavers. They had to prove that they had the physical endurance to be able to take these boats out to sea and back and forth. They had to show that they had skills in maritime knowledge of waters and currents and all sorts of things of that sort. Age made no difference. That you progressed in rank and responsibility over time as you grew in your job responsibilities. So as you started with the life-saving service, you would have a position as number eight or something of that sort, and you had certain duties along with the other eight individuals. But as you found that you could get a higher ranking position and you moved up to position number one, that the workload increased dramatically, and you may well now have been 60 years old. It was a remarkable, remarkable thing to watch that these crews do their job.
The only real solution to the problem of wrecks was to cut a canal across Cape Cod. The canal, however, was still many years and many failed attempts away. In the meantime, wrecks continued as a way of life on Cape Cod.
the Cape in the 1800s was very rural. I mean, we're, you know, 60 miles out in the ocean. It was mainly farming and fishing. The Cape, like a lot of the rest of the country, it was an agricultural society back in the 1800s. There was not much industry here. Although I find kind of interesting, Cape Cod specialized in a couple things that were unique here in terms of industry.
One of the earliest industries invented on Cape Cod was salt making.
Right after the Revolutionary War began, of course, they had no salt. So they had to invent something, which Captain John Sears of Dennis invented his salt works. The reason that Cape Cod was so famous for salt works is because it was so far out into the Atlantic Ocean. The water here is much saltier.
Basically, all it was taking seawater, putting it in vats, and letting the sun evaporate the water, so you're left with salt brine.
There were three separate vats, and there were three different levels. The upper level was where the animal and vegetable materials were precipitated out of the salt water. The second vat was where most of the lime was precipitated out, and the third vat is where they got the salt. When Captain John Sears started, he used to have to go down to the shore with a horse and buggy and a bunch of barrels, and he'd fill all the barrels with salt water and then lug them up to the salt works. And one man came along and said, "Well, there's no reason we can't pump it." So he invented the pump. The wind drove the salt mills and pumped the water up so that it saved them all that work.
When you looked out in the 1800s, all the shoreline was just loaded with all these odd-looking wooden vats up on stilt legs with covers that they would roll off and all that type of stuff. And then they had windmills to power the water along and all those types of stuff. So you really had a whole industry that was just oddly connected to the Cape, because we had a lot of wind, we have a lot of water, obviously. And for about maybe 40, 50, 60 years, that was a huge industry on the Cape.
What killed the salt works was the discovery of salt in upstate New York.
The fishermen still preferred the salt, the sea salt. So the ones in Provincetown and the ones in Yarmouth continued operating, but most of the others just folded up, so they just tore them down. And by 1850, most of them were gone, and most of the lumber was used in building houses. And they're still standing. They'll never rot because they won't hold paint either. Things were very difficult for the Cape Coders during the Revolutionary War because the British controlled most of the coastline here. Their headquarters were in Provincetown. The fishermen could not go out in their boats because they'd be captured by the British. So the general economy depended on what you could produce yourself. So in the early 1800s, they started with home industries.
Out of these cottage industries grew factories that produced everything from tacks to barrels to overalls.
They would get an order for so many pairs of pants or so many pairs of overalls or something, and everybody would go to work for a couple of months until the order was filled, and then they'd get laid off for maybe a week or two or three until a new order came in, and then they'd start work again. That's the way it worked. But everybody worked.
One of the most important of these early factories was in Sandwich.
The Boston Sandwich Glass Company operated from 1825 to 1888 in the town of Sandwich. There was a man, his name was Deming Jarvis, and he lived in Boston. He was an entrepreneur. And then in 1825, he decided that he would build the glass factory. He built a huge complex, and in 1825, July 4th is when they reported to have blown the first piece of glass. It's beautiful glassware. It's highly collectible by glass collectors today. It is almost set the standard for early American glassware and the quality it can achieve. It was in the 1850s that the glass company reached its height of production. And at this time, it's reported that they employed over 500 people. The glass workers at the factory were comprised of a variety of nationalities. He traveled over to England, Ireland, and Scotland to hire away from the existing glass factories over there talented and skilled glass workers. He was also very instrumental in bringing the Irish Catholic glass workers. And there were these Irish Catholic glass workers were the first Catholics on the Cape, actually. Jarvis really wasn't sure how the town would react to having a Catholic church here. So what they did is they brought down this building. It was prefabbed, cut in half, and it was floated over Cape Cod Bay. And it was basically put up overnight. It was at this time that the glass workers got together and decided to form a local glass workers union. So when the National Glass Workers Union called for a strike in 1888, the board of directors decided that they would close the doors, put out the fires, sell off their stock, and this tore many families in the town apart. Many of the buildings that were built for the factories were left abandoned, became dilapidated, had to be torn down. And glassmaking died in our area at the end of the 19th century. Glassmaking is on the rise again on the Cape. And what's really amazing is that these glass workers are using the traditional method of making glass with metal blowpipes, metal tools, tools that haven't changed for the last 1,000 years.
I've been blowing glass for 27 years. I learned from Robbie Mason from Edinburgh Crystal in Scotland. He learned from Geordie, who learned from Will, who learned from Bill. It's been passed down generation to generation, so all the trouble of the glass has been worked out. I don't have to think about, you know, how to figure something out. It's already been given to me by Robbie. The piece we're going to make is a presentation piece. It's a bubble ball goblet with two handles. So I blow out the bowl, then I add on a bit. It's called a Diablo. I just drop a blob of glass on, shape it. In glassmaking, you always work from the top down, and then it's reversed at the end so that I can finish the piece at the top. You have to keep heating the glass in to keep it warm. If it cools down too much, it'll crack. Then Don will bring me over another bit, same as the top, the Diablo. Henry will bring me over a foot made by this, made out of the same material, the apple or pear wood. And you can see that the piece, it'll squeeze the foot out into a nice disc with a nice little tapered end on it. As I work the piece, I shear it, I heat it in, and open it up to a slight flare, put the two handles on, and then knock it off. We're the oldest company in the United States, oldest glass company, and still in production. And we are known for traditional pieces, and we're trying to get away from that now. We're trying to go into a more contemporary, say, 70% of our work will be traditional, and we're going to get into the more contemporary, which is mainly just colors, unique shapes, not so uniform. We're looking forward to getting into that branch of it.
As Sandwich was dwindling as a factory town, down the road in Sagamore, what started as a small blacksmith and wheelwright shop was blossoming into an industry of its own.
By the time the railroad started to think about an expansion, the rail tracks, as it was laid out, went right through the property where Mr. Keith had started his small blacksmith shop. And they had started to develop a prairie schooners, as they were known, and also Conestoga wagons. The reason the Conestoga wagons were so sought after by the people on their westward trek was the fact that Keith made them more rugged than any other wagon that was known at that time. Mr. Keith built large apartment blocks for his workers. There was 40 of them. They still exist today by the existing ball field in the village of Sagamore. He built the first shopping plaza on Cape Cod right near the railway tracks. He built a large office complex that would house all of his offices. On the north side of what is now the existing canal on Savory Avenue, he built a series of homes, and they were known affectionately as Rainbow Bend. That went with the fact that each door had been painted a different color, and these were rent-free to his foreman. This proved to be beneficial many times after a payday and a Saturday night out on the town when the gentleman would come home and they knew that they had to go behind a red door or a green door or a yellow door of some type. By 1907, we started to see the massive construction that went on here in the village of Sagamore. And then all of a sudden we saw the development of a factory town. They were able to land a contract for 40,000 48 rail cars to be shipped to France by the middle of World War I. Now 48 stands for 40 men or 8 horses. By that time, the property that the car works was on was approximately a mile and a half in length. Total employment in all departments and its other offices and businesses that it ran exceeded 1,400 to 1,500 people, and today the largest employer on Cape Cod is the Cape Cod Hospital, which only employs 1,200 people.
The introduction of steel boxcars spelled the end for Keith Car Works. Today, Cape Cod Manufacturing and its name are known worldwide through Cape Cod Potato Chips, one of the newer industries on the Cape.
Cape Cod Potato Chips was started on July 4th, 1980, right here in Hyannis. They started it with one kettle, two employees, Steve and Lynn, and they began by making 200 bags a day. One of the things that makes our chips so unique is that we have gone back to the old-fashioned way of cooking them, where everything in our process is done by hand the old-fashioned way. So potatoes come in and they're all individually inspected, and we have pretty strict guidelines on what potatoes we'll take here. Then once the potatoes have made it by our first inspector, they'll go into our kettles, which is really what makes our chips so special, our kettles. They're hand-cooked, they're sliced directly into the kettle, and then our cooks will individually rake the batches of chips. The chips experience what I call quick fry, and the outside of the chip gets seared, and the inside actually contains less oil than the other way of manufacturing potato chips, making our chips a little bit lower in fat. The chips are also go into a centrifuge spinner, which after the process, which will spin off some of that excess oil. The chips then go onto a conveyor where they're all hand inspected. So this will be our second hand inspection of the process, which is rather unique. And once they've been inspected and they've been seasoned, they'll go into our packing machine where they'll be packed into individual bags and shipped off to market. Cape Cod Potato Chips is really a Cape Cod success story. From two employees, the owners, trying to make chips the old-fashioned way, not knowing where the company would go, we've been able to keep the business here on the Cape and grow to over 200 employees. And you can find Cape Cod chips in all over this country and in 5 other countries.
Prior to the trains arriving here in the middle of the 1800s, the primary means of transportation to the Cape and around the Cape was by boat.
Legend has it that one farmer grew a big crop of onions, and he had arranged to sell them to a distributor in Boston, but he had to get them there. So he hired a fisherman to sail them to Boston for him. So when the man's wife heard he was going to Boston, she wanted to go out and do some shopping. And then she told her neighbor, and her neighbor told her the other neighbor, and pretty soon the fisherman had a half a dozen women and other men all wanting to go to Boston to do business. And then he took them up there and along with the onions and then brought them back. So he figured, hey, this is better than going out on the, risking your life out on the Grand Banks. So he started running back in a regular trip back and forth to Boston, and before you knew it, every town on the Cape had their own packet going back and forth to Boston.
When you wanted to get, say, from the area of where Falmouth is to Hyannis, or from Brewster to Barnstable, you'd use a small packet sailing ship that would travel along the shore. It carried goats and mail and people, and that's how people and things got around down here.
Most of the Cape Codders in the 17th century would prefer to take the packet vessel to Boston rather than ride a stagecoach over the land, which had inherent dangers all the way through.
They had a regular route, and they went on regular days if the weather permitted.
But in 1850, things began to change when the trains reached the Cape. They hadn't had much need for regular stagecoach travel until the trains really arrived, because they couldn't even get people to Sandwich up until that point.
Even after the railroads came, some of them, just a few, were still running, and people preferred, some of the older people, preferred to ride the packet vessels.
Among the many factors that doomed the packet ships were steamers, railroads, and the Cape Cod Canal. New York financier August Belmont finally made the Cape Cod Canal a reality in 1914 when he opened the privately funded toll waterway that cut across from Sandwich to Buzzards Bay. Construction was made more difficult by huge glacial boulders that failed to show up in any test borings. But Belmont persevered, and after 5 years of digging and dredging, ship captains finally had an alternate route to sailing around Cape Cod. The canal also reduced the trip from Boston to New York by several hours. The tide often filled the narrow canal with sand, and soon this safe route was claiming wrecks. The federal government took over and eventually bought the canal, and in the 30s it was renovated as a works project. Two new highway bridges and a railroad bridge were constructed, and the canal was expanded to its present size and configuration. Gone were the tolls and treacherous rapids, leaving the Cape with the widest sea level waterway in the world.
One of our most famous early visitors to the Cape was Henry David Thoreau. The early 1850s, the train reached as far as Sandwich, and he took the train to Sandwich, and then he got on a stagecoach and took a stagecoach as far as Chatham, or down to the Chatham-Orleans area, and then he walked the rest of the way from there to Provincetown, and he wrote a book about it, and the Cape hasn't been the same since. Before 1850, there really were not inns for visitors to stay in. Transportation was the key, and once the trains reached as far as the lower Cape, inns began to pop up along the route. But the trains slowly made it all the way from Sandwich to Provincetown over the second half of the 1800s, so that by the 1890s, you could get all the way to Provincetown by train.
They would come down here and they would stay at a hotel. And we used to have big, sumptuous hotels all over the Cape. Every town had one, and there are still a few around.
In Dennis, there was a great Nobscussett hotel. It had 150 rooms. It was on 188 acres, and you could stay there for $15 to $25 a week, have everything from horseback riding and dancing and bowling and tennis and meals all included at that rate. Some people had some money. Not everybody had money, but there were those who did, and those who did knew how to have a good time, and they'd come and stay for quite a while. Whereas the average American really was not included in that vacation crowd, if you will. It was an upper income crowd that first came here and first began buying up land and building large summer homes. It wasn't really until the advent of the automobile that the visitorship and the tourism on the Cape began to change the Cape and make it start to look like the way that we see it nowadays. The Massachusetts Highway Commission actually monitored the traffic for 10 years on a section of road, which is now Route 6A in Sandwich. What they were measuring was the change between horse-drawn traffic and automobile traffic. In 1909, one day, they had 57 automobiles and 75 horse-drawn carts. And 10 years later, they had 23 horse-drawn carts and 559 automobiles. So you can see how things changed so dramatically in a 10-year period.
As soon as the automobile started to come in, people knew that they didn't have to hop on a train and get here and go back that way. They could hop in their car and come here. You started to get it. First you got tenting campgrounds, which was kind of interesting, you know. And then those turned into like cabin a cabin colony or a cottage colony.
The roads were a holdover from the stagecoach routes, and transportation was certainly nothing like it is today. The first automobile that made the trip all the way to Provincetown, actually it was an old open sort of Model T, and the driver had a lifeguard with him who had two large long wooden planks in the back of the car, so that when they were going through the dunes in Truro, the lifeguard could get out in front of the car and place these planks in front of the car, and they could drive the 15 or 20 foot length of the plank, and then he'd take the planks from behind the car and put them around in front of the car again so they could drive through the sand of Truro to get to Provincetown. And the next day, in order to get from Provincetown back to Centerville, I think, where they had started, they needed gasoline, and they were able to actually buy a quart from a druggist, which gave them enough gas to get the old car back to Centerville.
The Cape has always had summer visitors, and that's always had attractions for summer visitors, mainly lodgings. A big difference before the war and after the war is, after the war it switched to second homes, rental cottages. People had to figure out how to finance their second homes, so they rent them out. So there's been a big burst of second homes that always get rented. It's still the case today.
In 1940, the average American worker would only dream about a paid vacation. It was not part of their normal life.
Not until after the war would most people get a chance to travel to the Cape. And when they did it, they liked what they saw and came back often and in larger and larger numbers. As tourism grew on the Cape and land became more valuable, its agricultural base began to dwindle.
We used to have East Ham, for instance, where I live here. It was known for turnips and asparagus. But that was quickly going downhill in the Depression and in the 30s. And once you had your boom after the Second World War, people coming down looking for land, well, the farmers said, hey, why grow turnips? I can divide this up and sell. I can only sell one lot a year and make enough that I did when I was doing turnips. We still have some farms. You still have some nice little farms. You still have a little miniature industry. Cranberries are still an industry that's strong.
Henry Hall was a sea captain, and how he discovered the cranberry was the during the War of 1812, the British had our coast blockaded, and so he improved his time by cutting some trees down on his property, which it turned out had been a buffer between his cranberry bog. In the old days, they called him a cranberry yard. And the wind blew the sand onto the cranberry bog and covered it with sand. And he thought it probably was ruined. But the next time the season came around for the cranberries that had been covered with sand were much bigger and had better flavor than the ones that had not been covered. And that's how the cultivated cranberry industry was begun, really by accident.
We don't exactly know what the progression between that time and 1847, when the sea captains over here in Howitz got together to actually start an industry, a cranberry industry, which was a boon to the Cape Codders that lived in the vicinity of any of the bogs that were started, because it gave them an opportunity to be able to earn some money.
Most Cape Cod sea captains had a cranberry bog or two or three that they made money with.
Whole families would go out into the bogs at harvest time and help with the harvest. Schools would close until the harvest was in. Men and women used to pick with their fingers, and they'd pick into measures and then bring them up to the shore and toss them into the barrels and so forth. And then somebody got the bright idea that they could make a scoop that would be like fingers and could comb the berries out of the vine. So then they started using hand scoops to comb the berries off the vine. And then, of course, as man will do, he invented a machine that had a motor on it. And that also had the comb like fixture on the bottom of it that could comb through the vines and pick them up and mechanically put them into a container. The dry berries are used for fresh fruit. They go right into the market in packages the way you can buy them as a consumer. The wet berries are processed. They go into juices and sauces rather than in a fresh berry form. What we do is we flood the bog just above the tops of the vines, and we bring in our water harvesting machine, the water reel, and the berries float, but they're still attached to the vine. And so the water reel snaps them off, hits the water and snaps the berries off so that they're loose and floating. Then we have what we call boom boards that the men take out and attach to each other, and they bring them in big circles. And they can make the circle as big as they want to by attaching as many boom boards as they have. Then two men drag it around and form it into a circle. So you've corralled your berries up into a certain place, usually on the windward side. Park your truck over there that you're going to load, and the wind will help you, and you pull your berries into that particular spot where you've left the truck, corral them up, and then you open up the gate so that it can go up onto a conveyor that goes up into the truck. And the men just keep pushing, and up they go and into the truck. We fill up the truck and away it goes.
Cape Cod National Seashore is perhaps one of the more unusual national parks in the entire system. It's actually closer in maybe style and management to maybe parks in England and Europe, because they're places where the land is not entirely owned by the federal government, with easements and right-of-ways being the way that the land's preserved. Cape Cod's a blend of traditional national park and a very innovative approach of actually buying private property as well as allowing private property to remain within its boundaries forever. Way back even in the 1930s, there was an attempt to look at how many open space areas were there left on the eastern seaboard that were of national park caliber. And of course, World War II came along, put a stop to a lot of those initiatives. And after the war, it became apparent again that some sort of preservation on outer Cape Cod would really be beneficial to the American public. So the National Seashore came along in the early 1960s just in time to preserve the character of rural, wild outer Cape Cod, which is something that now is virtually disappeared from the rest of Cape Cod.
In many ways, the Cape Cod National Seashore foreshadowed the need to preserve rural Cape Cod. Today, land bank programs, zoning regulations, and water purity are high on the agenda of most Cape Codders. Cape Cod's problem is its popularity. As more people move to, retire, and visit the Cape, the more crowded it becomes and the harder it is to preserve the things that people love about it.
When I grew up in Dennisport, I knew every single person that lived in the village. I knew who they related to, and I knew what they did for work. And now I hardly know my next door neighbors.
All of Cape Cod life has changed, to my mind, for the worse, but that's it's not to knock it, but everybody likes to live 30, 40 years ago, I think, so.
When I was brought up here, there were 600 registered voters here. Today, there are over 6,000. So everything, multiply everything by 10, and gives you an idea of which way it's going.
During the summer, there's one or two places here that on a weekend, you'll find 12 to 15 cars in one driveway. Now, the heck with the cars. Can you imagine what's happening to that septic system?
If we don't have clean water, we more or less are dead in the water.
Every town has a local conservation commission, which ensures that the groundwater is protected. In Bourne, in Sandwich, there were laws protecting the groundwater and acre zoning as many as 8 years ago. Title V, which is a state regulation to ensure that your septic systems for individual homes are made in such a way that it doesn't pollute the groundwater. We get our water from one source, and that is the ground. That's why it's critical that we have environmental laws in place, local and in state laws, to protect the groundwater. Mass Military Reservation has its share of problems with polluting the groundwater. I don't think they knew, and I don't think a lot of other people realized how much the groundwater was polluted in the areas.
When all is said and done on the Cape, I mean, when the last lot is built out that can possibly be built upon, all we're really going to have left here is our history and our environment.
What you want is the right kind of quality development, the right kind of retail development that's necessary in the area. I think any new construction, particularly commercial development, should coincide with the character of Cape Cod, meaning that it should be aesthetically pleasing. There should be sign codes and historic regulations so that the type of commercial developments that are put, it doesn't matter if it's just a gas station building or a mall, it doesn't matter. It should adhere to the kind of codes that make Cape Cod so unique.
There's got to be some controls, some more controls put on. I mean, we've got the Cape Cod Commission now, which is limiting a lot of development.
There is tremendous support for land bank proposals, as there is with the Cape, where all 15 towns on the Cape voted to support land bank proposals, primarily because the state also supports that measure, where the state kicks in money to help the towns buy up property.
I hope it will still retain a lot of what it has today. Very soon, the Cape will reach build out. And what will happen then is that a lot of the old places will be torn down and people will start building trophy houses. We already see that happening. And it is, if it's allowed to continue, it will destroy the flavor of and the character of Cape Cod.
In the past, Cape Codders only had to contend with an unfriendly land and a dangerous sea. Today, they have to deal with each other. Each year, the ocean shrinks the Cape more, yet each year, more people come. The encouraging thing is that throughout her history, as the Cape has changed, her people have learned to adapt, and though she is just shifting sand, she will always be Cape Cod.